good morning, welcome to you brave ones who came out in the rain. As I said, we're Californians, we melt like sugar if we get in the rain. This is a special day because Father Bill Marquis is here. He's going to talk to us about healing, and then he's going to lay hands on each one of us. And so that, especially for the women who aren't going to be able to come to the retreat, you'll get that special blessing. But even if you come, you'll be doubly blessed. You're going to get that double portion. So anyway, I just would like to say we're going to just ask the Lord to be present with us now. And Lord Jesus, we just love you so much. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this time together. Thank you that you are the way and the truth and the life, and we can follow you, Jesus, and follow you and walk in your truth. And when we do, we have fullness of life, fullness of joy. And I thank you, Jesus, for that. I thank you for the Bible study that we've been working on, Lord Jesus. And thank you for this little bit of break that we have again. It's so fun to come together and not have to have a lesson, Lord, especially for me. So anyway, Lord, I just love you so much. And I thank you for each person here. I ask that you move upon us now in the power of your Holy Spirit to fill us with your presence, to let us know today the power of your love. Let it be experiential in some way for each soul here to know your presence with us, Lord Jesus. Let us know your love, your power, your healing, Lord, in whatever way we need today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, and I thank you, Lord. We're going to pass our love offering basket, and I thank you for all you provide for us, Lord. And so we bless your name now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
It's great to be back home. I love it here. When Angie asked me to speak today, I said, how long should I talk? And she said, oh, about half an hour. And I said, is that all? See if I can make this go up.
I guess not. You can tilt it.
Well,
yeah.
So we'll use the scripture that was for Mass today, correct? Is the one that you wanted us to use? Today's scripture is from Mark's Gospel. It's funny, I forgot my rosary. I feel incomplete without my rosary. It's back in New York, so I'll have to have my spiritual rosary with me because my physical one's in New York, Providence. In today's gospel reading, I think it was chapter 3, verses 7 to 12, Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lakeside, or the Sea of Galilee, and great crowds from Galilee followed him. From Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, Transjordan, the region of Tyre and Sidon, great numbers who had heard of all he was doing came to him. And he asked his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd to keep him from being crushed. For he had cured so many that all who were afflicted in any way were crowding forward to touch him. And the unclean spirits, whenever they saw him, would fall down before him and shout, you are the Son of God. But he warned them strongly not to make him known. And so on and so forth. I've been reflecting on this for quite some time now. And I was thinking about the context of our infancy narratives at Christmas time. And I was thinking about this reading from Mark's Gospel, which is at the very, very beginning of his Gospel. We're only in chapter 3. So I looked at the first verse, Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lakeside. So I thought, I'm going to go and check out some of the commentaries to see what they have to say. And sure enough, the commentaries all said about the same thing. They said, Jesus withdrew to pray with his disciples. Sounds good, right? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that's what we're doing. A lot of us are getting ready to do just that. We're going to withdraw to the mountaintop, and we are going to open our hearts again to the Lord, and we're going to say to him, do with us with whatever you will. We're here to serve you. We're here to do whatever you want with us, Lord, and give us strength. So we are going to pull away from all of our daily activities. I'm going to pull away from New York and all those activities and I'm going to go up to the mountaintop with all of you, and I'm going to join your retreat, not to give you a retreat. I'm going to be retreated. I'm going to join you. And I join you each year because I come back renewed. I come back refreshed and renewed by the power of the Spirit. And don't you kid yourselves for one moment. Don't kid yourselves. The power of prayer in this group is enormous. I've been all over the country. I've been all over the world. And it is rare that we see a group of people like this, so filled with the Holy Spirit. I was listening to your prophecies earlier today when you grabbed me and threw me in that room. And it was, I'm just playing with you. It was just amazing that I had been reflecting on this talk for a long time, because I want to do it right, I want to get it right, and all the prophecies reinforced all the things we're going to talk about. So I thought, everybody here is on the same page, and the power of the Spirit is so strong, it's affecting me, it's affecting you, it's affecting this parish, it's affecting Carlsbad. The power of God that flows through you is absolutely enormous, and it will have tremendous effect on the area, wherever you go and wherever you live. And so, what's the theme of today's talk? And I don't know. I have a couple of ideas. One is healing. But what was coming to me is this. I had a different theme in mind, but during our prayers this morning, I think what God is telling us is Jesus did not pull away from the crowds in today's gospel to pray. He was not pulling away at all. As a matter of fact, Jesus is building his church. He's building the new people of God. That's what he's doing. And this is why. Because in Mark's gospel, it's only chapter 3. We're just starting chapter 3. Well, Jesus just came out of the desert. He had just been in the desert for 40 days and 40 nights. He was tempted by the devil. And he struggled with the devil just like you do. Just like we do. We struggle with the devil every day in different ways, different forms. And we're overcoming temptation, and we're overcoming all sorts of things, all sorts of powers of evil that are coming at us. We're struggling with those all the time, as did Jesus in the desert. And when he came out of the desert, he emerged in power. And power flowed out of Jesus like we have never seen. It healed everybody in sight. Demons were running. He had power just flowed through Jesus. So the first message I have for you today is this. Jesus began his public ministry with prayer. That's how he started. I mean, he had spent all of his life in prayer. But now Mark the Evangelist, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is telling us that he began his public ministry in prayer. And so today, or this weekend, many of us will gather together and go up on the mountaintop to pray, because God is doing something new. Amen. He's doing something new in you. And he's going to prepare you through this weekend of fun and singing and dancing and praising the Lord, which is wonderful and beautiful. It's all participation in the kingdom to come. He's getting you ready for something brand new in life. He's building up his people. And this did not happen accidentally. It's very important. A lot of people miss this. Jesus did not withdraw to the Sea of Galilee to pray, because the last place you'd want to go is the Sea of Galilee. What most people don't realize is that the Sea of Galilee was at the center of the crossroads between the East and the West. Jesus grew up in Nazareth, which is around Galilee. Most people think that's some backwater bayou, you know. It was not. It was anything but some backwater town. Galilee was like New York City. It was like Chicago, San Francisco, or San Diego. This was a center of commerce with two basic huge trade routes. One trade route went out to the east, where the silk trade and all the spices and all that traveled from the east in China into the Roman Empire. The other road went to the south. It was called the road to the south. And that was the road that Joseph, the son of Jacob, got sold into slavery. It was the road used by Alexander the Great, and it was the road used by Napoleon. This was a major route that went right by Nazareth, along the sea, into Egypt and Africa. So Jesus was not growing up in some backwater bayou at all. He was raised right in the center crossroads of the world. And that did not happen by accident. Joseph didn't just go home one day and say, I think I'm going to kind of like it out here in Carlsbad, you know, ocean's right over there. I'm going to build myself a nice little house here by the sea. That's not what happened with St. Joseph at all. What happened was this, as you all know from the infancy narratives over Christmas, that when Jesus was born and the Magi came, they met Herod the Great, who was quite the character. Herod the Great murdered his wife and her mother, so he took care of his wife and his mother-in-law. He murdered the Sanhedrin, which is the Supreme Court. So our Supreme Court justices, well, Herod the Great didn't like the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of the Jews, so he had them murdered. Then he murdered three of his sons. Imagine that. His own kids murdered three of them. And so he was really a nasty character, and he's the one who murdered the innocents, the little boys who were under 2 or 3 years old, had them all murdered, because he heard that there was some king of the Jews who was going to be in competition. So he said, I'm going to take care of them. Well, the Romans loved Herod the Great. They thought he was just the cast me out, you know. It doesn't get any better. They loved Herod. But he died eventually, and he did have three sons who lived. One was, what was his name? I have it right here. Archelaus. Archelaus was just as bad as his father Herod. He was in charge of Jerusalem. Then there was another one called Philip, and he was out around Rome someplace. And then there was Herod Antipas. He's the one who had John the Baptist killed. And the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph and said, Joseph, don't go to Jerusalem. You go read it. Do not go to Jerusalem. Go to Galilee. Go to where Herod Antipas is. So as bad as Herod Antipas was, he was the lesser of the three evils. And Joseph was sent there by the Father in heaven. This was no accident that Jesus grew up in Galilee. He was sent there by his Father in heaven. And Joseph, St. Joseph, patron saint of the Dominican East Coast province, by the way, he's our patron saint. I mean, everybody's our patron saint. We have Mary's our patron saint. St. Joseph is our patron saint. You know, Mary Magdalene's our patron saint. We've got a lot of patrons. But anyway, Joseph is one of them. And Joseph was inspired by the Holy Spirit, by the angel, and he listened, and he discerned the word of God in that dream from the angel. He discerned that. And so my second message for you today is this, is that as God builds you up, builds us up, he will give you the gift of discernment so that you will be able to know what is of God and what is not of God. That is going to be a big help because we can waste a lot of time chasing after the things that are not of God. But discernment helps us to do the right thing. It's much more efficient. Discernment is a great tool of efficiency. We just do what we're supposed to be doing, and we get it right. And Joseph did. So Joseph was guided by the Spirit to bring Jesus to Galilee in the crossroads of the world. Discernment. Third, the Father in heaven did not want Jesus to be raised in secret in some commune away from the world. The Father in heaven wanted Jesus to be raised in the middle of the world. In the middle of the world, where the action is. That's where Jesus was raised. And Joseph and Mary, they had a job to do. Their job was to train Jesus in his human nature. Now, we want to make sure that we're clear. We all know that Jesus is divine. He is divine. He is God. No question there. However, church also teaches that Jesus was fully human. And he needed, in his human nature, a mother and a father, like we all do. He had to be like us in every way but sin. And so it was the job of Mary and Joseph to raise Jesus in a pagan world, because that's what it was called. The scripture called Galilee, pagan Galilee. And God the Father put his son in pagan Galilee. And God the Father is putting you in pagan Galilee. Yeah. Because he has something for you to do. He's doing something new in your life. So there's no escaping the world, ladies. I was going to say ladies and gentlemen, but ladies, there's no escaping the world, not at all. The Lord has called us to participate in his mission of salvation for the whole world. And so, that's what Jesus is doing. He is out there, and he's building the people of God, and he's doing it through incredible power. So he's not escaping to the sea, he's going right into the world, which is what we are called to do. And we see this message over and again throughout the New Testament, at least, maybe the Old Testament, but certainly the New Testament, where the Lord tells his disciples that you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world, which you've all heard. And we know. The other day, somebody decided to give a television set to the Dominicans in New York City. And so, in my room, I came back to my room in New York, and one of my assistants said, "Oh, Father, by the way, when you get to your room, you're going to find this TV set, big TV set. Nobody wants it because it's so big." I said, "Why do you put it in my room? It's this huge thing." So I went into my room, and there it is, this big television set. So the janitor was there, and he says, "Where do you want it?" I said, "Well, I don't know. Put it on my bureau, you know." And so I thought, let's see if we can hook this thing up. And I went to the back of the TV and tried to hook it up, and I couldn't see anything, so I went to get my flashlight. You know, the flashlight that you keep in the drawer, just in case you need it? Well, I went to get it, turned it on, and it didn't work. I couldn't see a thing. So the janitor said, "Father, I'll get you my flashlight." He went down, he got his flashlight, and it worked, of course, because he's the janitor, everything worked. Turned it on, and I was able to hook up the TV set. Ladies, the flashlight's no good in the light. The flashlight's made for the darkness. And you're made for the darkness, in a sense, because you are the light of the world. That candle sitting over there, you know, it's not doing us much good. It's symbolic, mostly. You turn out the lights and you'd see how that candle would light up the front. But that's what you are. You're the light of the world. And God doesn't want you hiding in some closet. You know, the bushel basket? Same idea. He wants you in the world because that's where you're going to be the most effective. People are going to watch the way you deal with struggling and suffering and temptation. They're going to watch you. And you're going to preach to them just by the way you live your life. It's going to be a sermon. It'll be the most beautiful sermon there is. You don't have to say a word. Just be yourselves and ask the Lord to let his light shine. And so you are all like those flashlights. And you are going to be most effective in the world. And that's where Jesus was. And you know, we read this right here in today's gospel, you know, that Jesus did whatever he was doing. He was healing and preaching. And it says right here he says, crowds followed him from all over the world. Well, people forget. He was in Galilee, the center of the crossroads. That's why people from Idumea, Jerusalem, Transjordan, Tyre, Sidon, etc., because God the Father placed him in the middle of the crossroads under the guidance of Mary and Joseph. And so, that's where Jesus was, to be the light of the world. Point number four. But Jesus did not just appear on the face of the earth, just like that. He was born. And he grew up in what I would call our triangle. We talked about the triangle. The triangle is the Holy Family. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, okay? The triangle of the Holy Family was right there. And so we are in this community of light. That's why you're here, because you're living in the world. You're living in a place that needs you, needs your love, needs your words of kindness, needs your mercy. Remember, mercy is undeserved goodness. It's undeserved. So somebody doesn't deserve our goodness, well, that's where we show mercy. Justice says you give them according to their due. Mercy says, well, they don't deserve our love, they don't deserve any of that, but we're going to give it anyways. That's mercy, and you are all called on a mission of mercy to the world. In order to do that, you need the strength of a community of faith. And that's what you're doing this weekend. You're going to go up to the mountaintop. Or, for those who can't make it, are going to go to church on Sunday, you're going to go to the meetings, you're going to be nourished in this community of faith. That's your triangle of life, is right here. And Jesus was placed within the triangle of life on earth. In heaven, he was with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And on earth, he's still in communion with the Father and the Spirit, but he's given an extension now with Mary and Joseph. But they had an important job to do, as do we all, as do you and me. It's all important. So, it is important for us and for you to continue to nourish this community of faith and this community of life. In this community of light, it will be a source of strength for all of you to face everything that is coming our way. So people were drawn to Jesus and they will be drawn to you. And we've heard testimony already about how people respond to God's invitation to prayer. They respond in different ways, you know, but in this case you got lucky. Your children said, yeah, let's go to church. That's unusual. So God must have been with you. In any case, they responded to Jesus, and they will respond to you because of what God is doing inside of you. Remember that as you show mercy and as you show God's love to others, they will respond in kind. It's an old theme that I've preached on many, many times, but it's a good reminder for me and for all of us that every human being, everything in the world was created in love, and they were created for love. And they recognize love, and they may fight love, but eventually they can't help but respond to love because they were made in love. And that's your children and their children and your spouses and everybody. It can be hard and difficult. That's why you come back together for more strength. But they were created in love. And so we see in today's gospel that people just flocked to Jesus. And these were pagans. These were not, some of them were Jewish, I'm sure, but most of them were just pagans because they were in Galilee. And yet they responded to Jesus because he reached out to them in love. And I was going to talk a little bit about faith and hope and piety, but maybe we'll do that over the weekend. It's really important that you stay connected to your community of faith here, either at St. Elizabeth or wherever you are, or in this community, because it will help, the work of God will help preserve you and me, all of us, from discouragement. It's easy to get discouraged, you know, you're working with your children and your spouse and your family and friends and trying to, we all want to see results right away. No, it's just natural, and I feel that way. You know, my family, this is not a perfect family. We've got kids all over the place doing their thing. And you know what I do? I try not to get discouraged. I just keep praying and praying and praying and praying. And every now and then, the Lord lets me know that he's listening. And every now and then, I get a little affirmation. That's okay, Bill, keep praying. And so I don't want you to get discouraged. I want you to keep coming back to church, come back to your community, your friends here, and share what God is doing, because God does not want you to get discouraged, because he needs you. He has work for you to do. He has a place for you in his saving mission for the world. So coming together saves us from discouragement. Now, finally, let's get to the healing. I was Angie said, wanted me to talk about healing. And I thought, okay, we can do that. I love healing. I need to be healed. I love to be healed. And I thought, but what do I say about healing? And so I was in the airport in Philadelphia coming out here. And that is one of the most dangerous airports to land in, because you may not leave. The weather in Philadelphia, boy, can change at any time. So whenever I go to Philadelphia, I always say a prayer to not get stuck there, because it's too expensive. So I was in the airport, and I went to grab a book that I was hoping to read. It was a book on psychology. I don't know what it was. It was something about the brain, something or other. Yeah, and I thank God I forgot it. I forgot everything. I forgot my rosary. I forgot my book back in Providence. So I was in the airport. I thought, well, maybe there's a bookstore with something interesting that I can read while I'm on the plane. It's a long ride over here. And I went into this bookstore. This lady, kind lady, said, oh, God bless you. I said, oh, I'm in the right place. Well, I wasn't dressed like this. I was dressed like all of, you know, like regular people, you know, in my sweater. And she said, God bless me. I said, I'm going to like it here. This is good. So I started looking around, and I saw a book on healing, you know. So I said, oh. So I kind of thumbed through the book, and it was a Christian psychologist talking about healing. And I thought, well, why not? So I bought the book. It cost me $12 or something, but it was really worth it. So I sat on the plane, but first I had to take care of the People magazines that people gave me. I had a few of those. I went through those, went out, and then I got to work. I read this book on healing. It was really a very good book, and I thought I would share a little bit of it with you, just a little bit of the book. It might help us. And then we will heal. We'll get down to business, and we'll start praying over anybody who'd like to be prayed over. So I'm thumbing through the psychologist's book on healing, and it was good. It talked about healing of memories, and you know what happens when you get stuck. That was kind of the whole point of the book. What happens when you get stuck? And you know, you're really angry with somebody, and you can't seem to shake the anger, or you're resentful. And I said, yeah, that's me. Yeah, I resent people sometimes. How do I get rid of the resentment? And I was saying, Lord, how do I get rid of the resentment? And I'm reading through this book, and the anger and all sorts of stuff that bother us, and we can't seem to get rid of them. Sometimes when I hear confessions, I get the same things. People will say, Father, over and over and over, it's the same thing, keeps bothering me. Well, you know, this psychologist explained to me that it's part of what happens to us as we grow up, that our memories and our experiences are part of our baggage, and it affects our neural pathways. It's chemical, too. So we grow up and we start to think in certain ways, and you can kind of think in those ways for 20, 30, 40 years, and we can get stuck in these ways of thinking that can be very detrimental to us. It can really take away our happiness. And psychologists said, you know, if you're thinking bad stuff, you're the one who's going to suffer the most. Yeah. Others around us will suffer, but we're the ones who are going to suffer the most. So he said, how do we deal with that? That's the part of the book I always like. You know, I mean, you'll have, you know, 150 pages of introduction. It's like this sermon I'm giving you now. It's like, get to the point, get to the point, will you? Stop this. So he said, what do you do? And I thought that what he had to say was really inspired. And he backed it up with Scripture, which we don't have time to do today. But it's all backed up with Scripture. Fundamentally, he says, we got to put on the mind of Christ. We have to put on the mind of Christ. So I said, okay, how do I do that? How do I put on the mind of Christ? So he gave us three little ideas that I offer for your reflection. And I think it's very good myself. He said, first of all, if we're stuck on something, whatever it might be, let's say you're angry at somebody, and you're just angry, you've been angry for 5 years, and it just keeps coming back. The Wall Street Journal says that's called ruminating, you know, when we're, you know, things are going around and around and around and we're in the car talking to ourselves and we're ruminating. Well, rumination is like, any of you from the East Coast know what it's like to get stuck in the snow.
Oh, yeah.
You know, right, okay, somebody's saying, oh yeah. The wheels spin and spin and spin and spin and we get nowhere. Well, that's rumination. You just get deeper and deeper into the rut. Yeah, it's true. So he says, well, that's partially chemical. Partially it's due to the chemical makeup because our memories affect us. They affect us physically as well as psychologically. So he says, those will come. He says, what you do is, step number one is you say, welcome, old friend. I know you. I know you. And he says, you got to name it. You know, I know you. Insecurity, I know you, jealousy, I know you, anger, I know you, resentment. You're my old friend, you've been with me for 30 years now. And so you gotta just name it. He says, don't push it away. Some people say, you know, get rid of it, get rid of it. He says, no, 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 just welcome it in. Don't make a big deal out of it. Come on in. And I said, okay, that's doable. And then he said, the next thing that you want to do is to give it to Jesus to be redeemed. Because you want that to be redeemed. And I thought, he's using the wrong word. He, you know, and I thought, because what redeem means is to buy back. So it's an old term, we don't use it, other than, unless you're in church and you're singing a song about redemption, but other than that, we don't use the word redeem. But it's very common in the Old Testament, in the time of the Jewish people. And the way it worked was like this. Let's say, for example, that I am married with kids, all right, and I don't pay my taxes. Well, the tax collector could say, okay, Bill Marquis, pay your taxes. And I say, I don't have it today. And they say, okay, that's cool. And calls the Roman soldiers over. Roman soldiers take me and my family, and they put me in a work camp, or they give me to some rich person. And then I work for that, and my kids and wife and I work for this rich person until we generate enough money to pay my taxes. And once my taxes are paid, I've been redeemed. And if you have a rich uncle or a rich brother, your brother can come up to the tax collector and say, I am going to pay his taxes for him. So my brother Roland pays my taxes, and I am redeemed. I am set free, okay? And so what this author meant to say was we have to give this over, whatever it is, this anger, this resentment, and we give it to Jesus and ask him to set us free, to redeem that, to help us let it go. And we need grace to do that. We do. We just need grace. And we do our part. Of course, we do our part, and we give it to the Lord. But that is a concrete step that we can take. And God will honor that prayer. He will honor that gift. Jesus, I give this to you because I can't do anything more with it. I mean, I've done what I can, and I've been suffering with this stupid thing for 30 years, or 40 years, or 5 years, or 1 week, or whatever. I give it to you, Jesus. And then you say, bye-bye. You're now Jesus's. You no longer belong to me. You have been redeemed. And then in an hour, 1 hour later, it comes back. And you say, welcome back, old friend. Welcome back, old friend. And I'm giving you to Jesus. You don't belong to me anymore. Bye-bye. And then get on with your life. And you just do this over and over and over. And I thought to myself, if I may say this, I thought that was really inspired. I thought this was a really, really good idea. So I thought, I'm going to share this with the ladies here at the retreat. And now this applies not only to healing of memories, but anything. It can apply to anything in our lives. Anything that's broken. Anything that's not right. Any lack of wholeness. We can give that over to the Lord. And when we do that, we put on the armor of Christ. We can use all kinds of symbols, you know, symbols. The armor of Christ. Put on the mind of Christ, be transformed by Christ. All those words, all those symbols mean healing and making whole. So, That's a lot of stuff. I got it done in a half hour. I could either open it up to questions, or we could move on to whatever you like, Angie.
We'll move on to prayer.
You want to move on to prayer. Okay, well, but that's my message for you today. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thank you.